Hello guys, welcome back to our channel. This is David from We Are Growth Hack, and I'm here with my friend Jason Lee. Welcome to our channel. How are you doing?
Doing great. Yeah, it's great to have me on here.
That's amazing. So where are you right now?
So I'm currently based in Taipei in Taiwan, which is always a funny question because my partner in our company is in Shenzhen. And sometimes our sellers ask me, are you in China? And I'm always like, depends on what your definition of China is.
Exactly. The political definition, I guess, here, right?
Or I'll be like, kind of.
I get the same thing when they ask me. Before, they used to ask me, are you in China? And I said, well, technically, I'm in Hong Kong. And now they're asking me, are you in China? I said, I mean, my company's in Hong Kong, but, you know, we are relocated here to a different place. And sometimes we better not say that. So for you guys who've been following us, I'm currently relocated in Phuket for 2 years now. Some quick updates. We've been very busy. We're getting all of our team here. So we're working a lot. And we haven't been able to actually share a lot of content lately, but we're going to start some new series. And we have today here, Jason is going to be the first one from actually FBA Flipper. So we're going to talk about, you know, how to exit your business, how to flip your business. And I guess Jason is a very great person here to talk about this very topic. And I will just let you speak because I guess you will know better how to introduce yourself and how, you know, tell us about FBA Flipper.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm actually not 100% sure familiar with your audience, but I assume, you know, you'll have some relevance to this. So I'm originally from Boston and, you know, graduated, grew up there, et cetera. And then I worked for several years for Empire Flippers. I don't really consider them a competitor, but doing similar things to help people selling their online business, not just Amazon businesses, but content sites, SaaS, web app, et cetera. And during that time, I was intentionally basing myself in Shenzhen because I could see that a rising tide lifts all boats and that Amazon was heavily courting Chinese Amazon sellers to sell on Amazon, and that eventually there'd be an opportunity to sell Chinese Amazon businesses to the Western world, to buyers in both, you know, North America and Europe. And so that's what I've been doing for the past year, basically since the pandemic caused a lot of capital to rush in. And then given my unique background of being Chinese American, being based in Shenzhen, having worked for Empire Flippers, I had this not just language and cultural overlap, but also M&A and knowledge about the Amazon industry. And then also meeting my business partner, who I actually met from helping him sell his business before. It's that kind of unique combination that enabled us to start this.
So this is interesting. I think it probably, are you guys the only company who's actually focusing right now in the Chinese market?
Yeah, so we know that there are Chinese that reach out directly to these buyers, which is okay. But generally there's issues of language and culture and understanding. They just don't fully get it. We know that there are some that reach out to the other brokers out there. Again, it requires language skills, which is a bit difficult. And also understanding, you know, it's not just language also, though. There's also the firewall. Like a lot of our clients send us files on Baidu, but Baidu is only accessible within China. So that's why I have employees in China. And then there's issues of capital control, like getting money into China. All these kind of things are make it really difficult to transact. It's not simply language. If you're like, oh, I did it in Israel, or oh, I did it in Eastern Europe, like, yeah, we can do it. It's like, no, it's a little different in China. And like we work completely in WeChat for our sellers and on email with our buyers. And then there are other quote unquote brokers out there that we know of in the China market who try to reach out and just refer without doing a full end-to-end service. They don't do any pre-vetting to make sure the business is good. They don't check the numbers. They don't really even fully understand the requirements. They just try to get the referral fee from the buyer. And that's how they try to make money. You know, that's what the buyers, other buyers tell us, that we're the only legitimate people who understand what buyers are looking for.
Yeah, this is actually a very interesting topic. Let's get back to the very first step that you were explaining about, you know, this barrier to the entry in this Chinese market that we're talking about that in our channel, and you know, everyone's been talking about that since the very beginning, you know, international mm-hmm. trading and business, why a lot of Western companies or Western businesses fail in China. So I think that having a company, an intermediary like you guys is actually crucial to the success. So you're pretty much facilitating the job for the Western aggregators, if I'm correct, to actually purchase Chinese sellers.
I mean, our commission and we're actually more of a sell side, so we earn from the seller a commission on their sale. Mm. And so I would say we're more on the seller side, but it definitely helps for the buyer to work with us because we're a fully bilingual team. So any of the buyer seller calls, we're interpreting and translating any of the documents from Chinese to English, vice versa. We're in between, helping get it along. One thing that we can't fix though is time zones. So we do have to stay up late sometimes, especially Europe, you know, it's afternoon, or US and it's evening or morning. So it is smoother working with us than working with someone who, you know, his English isn't that great. They don't understand it. But then it's like, there's so many systems I think people don't realize in China don't work well. For example, Zoom doesn't even work that well. And so we have to talk to our clients over Tencent meetings, which it does work through WeChat, thankfully. But even that can be buggy if you're outside of China. There's all these weird things. Sometimes I actually wish I could VPN into China to save myself trouble. But I don't think anyone would ever do that kind of business.
Yeah. I know the feeling. I mean, I've been living in China in the mainland for around 3 years, and then 3 more years around in Hong Kong. So I know the struggle of, you know, dealing with this internet issues, connectivity, and you know, when you're into a Zoom call and then the call just shuts down for no reason apparently. But yeah, this is part of the game.
So well, there's also like search engines that only work if you have IP addresses in China. And then, for example, our website, our Chinese version of our website, which we add an S to it, we actually had to move it over to Ali Cloud so it can host it there and can load faster in the Chinese internet. Because if you're living in mainland China, you probably know that there's like domestic internet and then international internet. And so like our sellers who are selling their business would come to our website and they complain that our Chinese website would be super freaking slow. And so we were like, okay, we got to split our website. One domain for English, one domain for Chinese, and just different hosting and just... Yeah,
that definitely makes sense. It definitely does make a lot of sense. Yeah. I completely agree here.
And then like the marketing is completely different. Like if you think, oh, hey, you know, I'm from the West. I'm going to use Baidu because that's like the equivalent of Google. Or I'm going to use like Weibo instead of Twitter. I'm going to look for the latest gurus in China. It's not one-to-one comparison, right? Like, there's Baidu, but Chinese don't search on Baidu like Westerners search on Google. Instead, they hear information more through WeChat in different circles and like WeChat articles and WeChat, they call KOLs, key opinion leaders, what we call influencers. And so it's like, it's really hard explaining that most of the marketing is actually either WeChat or sometimes we've been hearing a lot more about Douyin, which is TikTok, Chinese TikTok, or in-person conferences is a big thing. I remember reading a job description of a Western Amazon service company that was trying to enter the China market. And it was kind of funny because they were like, we want someone with Chinese email marketing experience and Baidu SEO experience. First of all, asking a Chinese to use email is like asking an American to use fax. like they don't use email. They just use WeChat because you can send files on it. Or you can use Baidu Pan, which is Baidu Cloud. So no one uses email. And second, no one really uses search the same way. The search results are terrible. And it's not like a sync, like Chinese in China will use Google to search in Chinese sometimes on China. Like it's fragmented. Yeah. It's really hard to explain these differences unless you've lived and experienced it.
Yeah, I remember, for example, if you're looking for a place to eat, you wouldn't really go and look, you wouldn't do the search on the Google on Baidu. Yeah. You wouldn't do that.
You'd be Dazhong Dianping.
Exactly.
Or Meituan. Yeah.
Yeah. So actually from the Western side, who can you actually help to get in China or, you know, to do better business with Chinese sellers?
Yeah. So we have our own marketplace of sellers that are interested in selling. We've pulled their numbers, calculated it, asked them some basic information and gotten a sense of what kind of price they're looking for. If it's, you know, way above market value, we won't do it. But of course we have to balance, you know, what the sellers want versus market, you know, market reality. And we don't do, you know, be clear, we don't do due diligence. That is always the responsibility of the buyer, but we do know what goes into due diligence because we've been through it so many times at this point. So for example, something unique about the China market is searching the legal entity behind it. So it's usually like a Chinese company, usually not sometimes an individual, but usually a Chinese company. And then searching that with a lot of the buyers that hire an outside legal firm in China to do this, because these systems, again, only can be used in China. I can't even use it here in Taiwan. You can use public registries to search who the owner is, and then who that using that owner, who what other companies they own, and then you can kind of check, you know, do they have competing products? Do they truly own the trademark that you're that they say they? Well, I mean, that's easy. The USPTO side is easy for the US, but then do they have a trademark in China?
Yeah,
you know, because that's important, because a factory who could register a trademark for a seller on their behalf could then have their seller by the balls and hold them captive to using them only. So like, you know, if someone says like, oh, I don't have a competing storefront, well, it's like, let me just search the competitors' company's names and find out who the legal person is behind it to make sure that he really doesn't own it. Because they might have different legal entities under it for companies, but then ultimately to the same person.
Yeah. So actually this is, you know, doing due diligence in China, I think it's going to be really a headache for Western companies, especially unless you have a team, a proper team in China, unless you know how to do business with Chinese companies, Chinese entities, unless you know really how Amazon works the way that they do it in China, because we've been talking about this for so long, you know, how to discover, for example, if they do black hat, if they manipulate reviews, etc. And this thing you just said before about the competition, like future competition or potential competition of the brand that just bought from the very same company or the very same owner is actually a fact. And I remember when I was starting to talk to some of my Chinese friends and connections just at the beginning of this year, and I was introducing them to this new trend of the aggregators, you know, Amazon FBA aggregators. And most of them, they were just asking me this, it might sound like naive question, but it's not naive because it really shows where this kind of entrepreneurs try to ask you first. They would ask me, why would I sell my business to someone else if I can, if I already own the data, and then I can just, you know, copy the same product and launch it again and compete against the first business that I was running, you know. So this is already in the mindset, so you really have to be careful. So it's really important to do your due diligence and to know the market where you're trying to, you know, purchase something, like buy a seller in China.
China definitely had to push the envelope. Like if there's a rule, then their first thought is, how can I get around that rule? I mean, it's a different culture and mindset. It's not like rule by law and we're under it. It's like, okay, here's the law. Now, how can we both get around? How can I manipulate, use it to my advantage, right? How can I use Amazon's report system to attack competitors?
This is definitely what would happen, you know, in the back of the mind, you know, of some Chinese sellers. A lot of them, they told me this very thing.
And you know, like there's like, so we get, you know, account health screenshots and stuff like that. We have, I'm sure there's a thing in the inventory health. Something that we learned was that there's account health, and Chinese, they try to be clever and they try to use many different legal entities, but then share accounts with different brands and have the same brands on multiple accounts. And the idea is that if one account goes down, they still have others they can kind of use, right?
Yeah.
It's like child accounts, you might call them. Then you have like sacrificial accounts. But Amazon is smart. They've linked it all together. They know with, like, oh, let me use a VPS, a virtual private server, so that I can hide my IP and it can't detect it. No, Amazon knows. And it's something that we encountered. You know, there's a huge shutdown between April to maybe August, September this year of Chinese Amazon businesses. And what we learned, there is something called, I actually forget the name of it, but there's a back-end system only accessible to internal Amazon employees on in Amazon India and Amazon Seattle. Not available in Amazon China or the UK because employees are corrupt, and then
because they know already if they're going to leak information.
And it was a health score on these brands and these accounts that was linked together. So on the back end of Amazon for the seller, it might show their health as healthy, but Amazon has their own credit report they don't show. And so we were given some information that one of our sellers, who was being suspiciously too pushy about his business to sell,
wanted to get rid of it.
Yeah. And then eventually his main account got shut down. So we were like, okay, you know, that explains it.
So do you know why? I mean, he got banned, or do you know what was the problem?
So like we heard from one buyer that he has had bad account stuff. And an exact reason why weren't told. But then another buyer who was in the same category as this person selling the business, noticed, hey, this is a competitor of mine. And they do this black hat stuff. They take over dead ASINs. I've seen them do that. Mm. They swap things out. Like that's probably, and then, well, you know, lo and behold, it happened. So not to say that there aren't legitimate companies out there. It's just that in the wild days, in the beginning, when Amazon was opening the Pandora box of Chinese sellers, it came about. Because like if you talk to any Chinese, not even just a seller in the e-commerce industry, like about brushing, which is fake reviews. Yep. You know, the most casual person on the street knows what brushing is because it's so common on Taobao. So they see 1,000 reviews, 10,000 reviews. They're like, oh, the first couple thousand are probably faked. But like, it was kind of a new thing for like Americans to be like, ooh, fake reviews. And like, how much can I trust this? So it's like, yeah, you're coming from this, I guess, slightly naive Western point of view, entering, a place in the world where it's all about leverage and gaming the system to your advantage. And I think Amazon has kind of put the you know, like set the rule and the gavel down to be like, finally, no, we don't want that. We don't want negative reviews. No more inserts, which is a big thing. They're trying to clean up that thing. And so we've noticed, you know, we ask our sellers, had your product inserts, and they're like, we got rid of it in May. Like once Amazon cap started turning down, like we got rid of everything, stopped doing any funnels, stopped doing it, like just like trying to clean up, which has made it more difficult to sell on Amazon. Mm-hmm. But it's also cleaned it up, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like a lot less black hat than I used to experience back in, you know, 2018. People were always super crafty about you can do this and you can do that. And I still hear about new ways, but it's like, it's only going to last for so long.
No. Even less than before, you know, before a black hat, you know, technique, depending on how good or bad it was, it would last from, you know, a couple of years to a couple of months. I remember we even wrote like one specific blog post about that, you know, having multiple accounts. They call it metrics and Cobra, you know, creating zombie listings, you know, this apocalyptical, you know, terminology does this too. Actually, I definitely agree. You need to know what are you going against and what are you up to. You know, the culture where you actually want to do business. And a lot of the aggregators that I'm in touch with, they find it very hard to actually enter the Chinese market. And I would say that definitely helps to have a team in place in China, but also definitely helps to get in touch with some localized agencies or agencies that know the market in China because they've been there for so long. And, you know, I actually wanted to ask you something here. How does your workflow actually works? How does it start from the beginning when you receive an inquiry and then, you know, you present your pool of sellers and then how does it get until the end?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. So, you know, talking about other aggregators, especially that are already in China, we hear through the grapevines how many deals they've actually closed. And when we work with them, we can actually kind of realize, oh, okay, they may have said they did this, but based on our experience, they actually haven't done it. You know, getting money to China is a perfect example of some of the issues. And like, I'm pretty sure we've done the most deals in China. And sorry, going back to your thing, what's the process look like? Generally, first, it's education on the seller side. And we have filtered through, scraped Amazon and checked out how many of those sellers on Amazon that are Chinese are actually a good fit for aggregators. Because you read things on like other websites such as Marketplace Pulse that, you know, 50% or 4% of sellers on Amazon, based on revenue, I think, not in this number of accounts, because number of accounts, Chinese always have multiple, are based in China. And yeah, on a revenue basis, it may be. But when you actually pull the margins and calculate the actual margins, it's not great. You look at the type of account and it's super mixed. It's in Chinese called puhuo, just basically a general shop of, you know, throw stuff over the wall and see what sticks. 98 pages worth of products because they have all these complex software systems to manage all these accounts that a Westerner doesn't usually have. And so when everything was said and done, after we scraped a couple hundred thousand, sorry, not 100,000, maybe like 20, 30,000, Chinese sellers, Of those, only like 12,000 met our revenue requirements. And then of those, I think only like less than 1,000 were actually a good fit in terms of revenue, based on just revenue and net and fees, what we could estimate from the outside, So I want to emphasize is that like a Western seller, you're more likely, if you're in a, you're going to buy a business, to have a better fit. And then for us, we have to be the firewall filtering out a lot of stuff.
It's more about quantity in
China, it's quantity actually. To get out like just that little, that one, less than one, I think it's 1.5% is what we calculated of what we got from 12,000. That was a good, that we were like, if we get this, then this we know this will sell.
Actually, this definitely makes sense a lot, because I remember getting a lot of inquiries sometimes, for example, by companies who wanted to have some consultation on, you know, Amazon, how to be number one, especially in those very competitive categories where they had always this newcomer seller from China that was smashing their market share, you know. And I was actually telling them, you know, they are actually giving up a lot of the profit, because probably they are coming from bigger companies, or they are a conglomerate of brands. Like, for example, Aoki is doing, this is something that I was telling already like almost a year ago, before Aggregators was a very big thing. Mm-hmm. Actually, Chinese brands, they were born all in the same main company that used to, you know, put out together every year, five different brands, you know.
Yeah, they're different small pocket teams that are competing with
exactly.
each other.
Exactly.
Fighting.
So they compete within each other, they compete with the Western sellers, they compete with other Chinese sellers, so the competition is super fierce, and your margins are getting smaller and smaller and smaller, especially because Amazon is so competitive and it's so expensive to be at number one, especially the super, you know, competitive categories like power banks, mm-hmm. you know, electronics, and Chinese sellers, they all go compete into those categories because they approach the, you know, the business in a different way. So the margins are going to be very, very small if you want to compete with this kind of sellers.
Yeah, exactly. That's the biggest issue, is that when we filter through these businesses, you know, a lot of Chinese are in electronics, a lot of them are in fashion, a lot of them are in parts. And those just aren't a fit for these Western buyers who are looking for, and also, you know, Chinese can, you know, we saw this big business that was making $100,000 a month in net profit. It sounded great. Its margins were 6%. 6% margins. So like, you know, yeah, the nominal number, that sounds, it's great. But if you think about how much capital you have in to the return, you're like, well, at that point in the operations, that was before putting in like OPEX. At that point, you may as well store it in the stock market, like, you know, get better returns that way. And so for Chinese, it's still worth it, though, in a weird way, because real estate, super risky right now with the whole Evergrande, and it's basically just a giant bubble. Stock market in China is a speculative bubble. Speculation, not even just bubble, just speculation. And so in China, there's subsidies to sell to be e-commerce sellers. So they can earn from that. They can earn from government subsidies. And then before July of this year, before Amazon Europe implemented some rule for VAT, you know, some sellers would come to us and be like, oh, we should count that as profit, that VAT. And I'm like, no, but the buyer has to pay the VAT. Like, yeah, but we got the profit. And it's like, no, but the buyer takes it over. They can't get that same like advantage that you got, or claim that government subsidy or whatever. So for them, it can be worth it. But for a Westerner taking it over, it's not.
Let's go back to the process. So let's say have identified the right seller to the buyer in the West. Then how does it work? What are the next steps?
It's all a funnel. So first thing first, we ask some high level numbers. You know, how many accounts do you have? And like, where are you selling? Just to make sure that they don't have 30 different accounts, and also argue the factory. Generally, not as many people are factors as you think, but we just still need to ask it and know about it. And then what's your expectations, what's your margins, stuff like that. Just high level numbers, unverified, just to make sure. Then from there, we give them a rough valuation, be like, hey, it could be roughly like this amount. Then it goes on to, if they say yes to that, we'll then get their information from Amazon. The actual reports will get generated on screen, send it over, crunch those numbers to build a P&L, and give them the valuation based on that. If they like that, then we ask them further questions, about 30 or so questions about their business, operationally, who runs it, are there partners, how do you know supplier, et cetera. And then, you know, if they're happy with the valuation, we hope happy with their responses, which we've translated all to English, then we from there we do like a mock interview with them to help them coach them on how to answer the questions, and then we present it to buyers to see if there's any interest. And you know, individually message buyers, be like, hey, this is a business that you mentioned, you're sort of in this category, I'll try to get it, hop on buyer seller calls, interpretation, we have to deal with time zones, and then sort of collect all LOIs for a business, usually within about maybe about 2 to 3 weeks of launching the business, depending on the size of the business. From LOI, then it goes into exclusive due diligence with one of the buyers. And then, you know, however that long that takes, we try to keep it under 2 months, preferably 40 days, but we know things ended up getting stretched out. A lot of these aggregators end up using a third party for financial due diligence. So that sort of extends that their legal due diligence counsel somewhere else. And then it, like, you know, it just takes a while. And we help review the contracts for that. We go through the contract, the 60-page contract in English, but explain it in Chinese to the seller so they understand it. But this is like after we do some revisions on our own end to make sure it's a good fit. And then, you know, sign the contracts. So just, it's, I'll admit, right? How do you enforce contracts in China? It's all about leverage, about where the money is. So it's like, these are just agreed upon terms, but things will obviously change. So we sign the contract, money gets into escrow. Then we start the migrations, which we got to make sure, especially for Europe, you go through, it's called KYC, you know, your customer, get Amazon's approval. Once the account is transferred over to the buyer in their full control and there's 48 hours have elapsed without Amazon saying an issue, then the money generally leaves from escrow. And then about 60 to 90 days, depending on what we've negotiated, there's usually a reconciliation period. Because, you know, when you're selling an Amazon business, it's a moving target. So how much money is in inventory is a constantly changing number. So you set a date, but you can't necessarily take a screenshot of that date because it's already moving. So also the account balance and stuff like that. So we reconcile about 60, 90 days after any inventory that was in transit, any inventory that was in production that the seller had paid for, you know, it all gets fixed 90 days later. And then there's, you know, stability payment or other stuff that comes in there.
Definitely. Jason, I guess we're going to wrap up soon, but I have some few questions that are, I think most of the listeners here, they want to know. So we know the Chinese market is very hard to crack, but tell us some numbers. How many businesses you were able, ready to, you know, successfully transfer or help to, you know, to this transition? And when did you actually guys start? So from the beginning until the end, if you can give us some rough numbers or some different categories, or, you know, this might really help to understand how it's going. And is this evolving? Do you see that it's easier now than it was before? Or what would you say here?
I actually have to clarify on your question, because are you trying to break into the Chinese market? Like, you want to sell products into China? Because that's like a whole different thing. And that's a whole other topic. Like, you know, China skipped over retail and direct to internet, which is why it's actually more developed in e-commerce than the Western world. But if you're talking about like how many businesses we sold 17. We started about July of last year, but we started really picking up end of last year, early this year. And then we had a slight lull over the summer, which is actually typical seasonal. My experience being in this business since, you know, 2018 or so, that it is a seasonal thing. It's going to be high season very soon.
Okay. So the high season is, I would say, right before Chinese New Year. Is that correct?
Yeah. It's on Q4. Or like people are back from, you know, summer vacation. And then the biggest usually is Q1. And the reason being is they've earned their Christmas money cash and now they're willing to cash out. And then like Q2 is okay. But then like it sort of hits summer and people start like thinking about vacation and people are off.
Yeah.
Especially Europeans in August, like we know.
I remember when I was in China that Chinese New Year normally dictates the beginning of something new and the end of something old. So for example, if you want to leave your job, I remember that a lot of Chinese companies that were facing this issue that after Chinese New Year celebration, a lot of employees wouldn't show up because they already found a new job. They wouldn't even send a, you know, 30 days notification. They just wouldn't come, you know, or they would send notification like, because the holidays are so long, it's like 3 weeks holiday. So you can just work 1 week and then you get paid for the remaining 3 weeks. You don't have to show up at work. So this is also, once again, a cultural difference. I wanted to ask you here, this is super interesting. give us please some quick tip for sellers, whether you know Western or Chinese sellers. What are you seeing right now? How do you see Amazon evolving? And you know, if someone is thinking about selling their business or even grooming their business and you know multiplying just by themselves and then potentially getting an exit from their business. You have been in this industry for a while now. Also, you are based in China. You're doing business with Chinese sellers, so you've seen a lot of things. What are your top advices here?
I'm reluctant to give advice because although I did start an Amazon business after I left Empire for First before I started this business, I would not say I'm a massively successful Amazon seller. So I would say though that there is still hope for a Western Amazon seller. Chinese, they definitely hit a limit. They are well optimized on supply chain. It's very hard to beat them on those prices, on their connections, et cetera. But their listings are still super chinglishy. They have a really hard time working with the outside world because of the firewall. They, up until the pandemic, I noticed they were very reluctant to use platforms like Upwork or Fiverr. Now they're more willing to. And so I think Westerners still have a good chance with higher margins and better understanding of the end customer. The Chinese don't understand. And who knows, given the supply chain issues and China-US relationship, I used to think that there was at least 5-10 more years of runway of China being the factory of the world. I think that future of sourcing, my background is mechanical engineering, is that you should actually source if you can in Mexico. The issue is that no other country in the world is as consolidated and easy to search as the platform using Alibaba. You know, I've heard of people who manufacture in Mexico or Vietnam, they want to make something like a pair of pants. They got to source the button and zippers from China. They get the fabric in Vietnam, but they can't actually source the other components. You know, who knows with 3D printing technology, et cetera, we'll move to the US. But I do know that for manufacturing runs generally under 10,000 units or 20,000 units, it's more advantageous to do it in Mexico, despite the higher cost of labor and the other issues, because the shipping is easier and you'll never have to worry about like ports being closed because it's the US-Mexico border, NAFTA. And so I think the future where things will move is sourcing from there.
Definitely. So taking into consideration, particularly your supply chain, mm-hmm. And yeah, we see that this is crucial right now. And I mean, who wasn't ready for this 2 years ago really had some big problems. We know that. Yeah. Some of our clients, they were really facing huge problems that, you know, caused a big slowing down in their business. And
even Apple has issues.
Yeah. You know? Well, that was really good. We always keep our videos super short. And mm-hmm. Thank you so much for the amazing information. So how can people get in touch with you?
Yeah, they can hit me up at jason@thefbaflipper.com, or you can go to our website, thefbaflipper.com, and there's a call link, book call with me. Pretty open to meet new people, do these things.
That's amazing. So thank you very much. I see that the background city in your screen is Shenzhen.
Yes, Ping An Financial. Yep.
Ping An Building. That's really good. Some of the aggregators are actually there. They actually have an office there, if you know.
I know.
Good. So let's go and pay them a visit. I actually miss Shenzhen. I haven't been there for, I think, more than 2 years now. So
same.
when this whole pandemic will be over, I think I'll see you there probably.
Yeah. Cool.
Okay, cool, Jason. Thank you very much and see you next time.
There you go.
Bye bye.